This is Be Delivered Bible Study with Adam Hall. And today, we're going to learn what is the truth. John chapter 8, verse 32 says, "Ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." One thing the church teaches is that the truth will make you free. And yes, this says that, but pay attention to that word, know. You shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Let's say you've got an uncle that's a millionaire, and you're the sole survivor, and that uncle leaves you his entire fortune, but you didn't know that he put you in the will and left you all his fortune. Now, it's true you're a millionaire, but if you don't know that you're a millionaire, you'll still live in debt, in poverty, or wherever it is you were at in your circumstances. But had you known the truth, then you would have been set free. So, it's not the truth that sets you free, but the knowledge of the truth. And the truth starts with love. 1 John chapter 4, 10 says, "Herein is love, not that we love God, but that He loved us, and sent His Son to be the propitiation for our sins." And if you read on down to verse 19, you'll see it says, "We love Him because He first loved us." We don't even know how to love with our human ability. It took God's expression of love to teach us how to love, to show us how to love. And until you have an understanding of just what His love means and how it operates, it's impossible to truly love with our own understanding without the knowledge of His love. In the Gospel of John, chapter 19, we see a picture. In that book, five times, John refers to himself as the disciple whom Jesus loved. But we're just going to point out one of these just to bring in the point that John was focused on Christ's love for him. "Now there stood by the cross of Jesus his mother, and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Cleophas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus therefore saw his mother and the disciple whom Jesus loved standing by, he said unto his mother, Woman, behold thy son. Then he said to the disciple, Behold thy mother. And from that hour that disciple took her into his own home." The point here is that John is the disciple whom Jesus loved, because this is his gospel. So he's referring to himself. He was the only disciple at the cross. None of the other 11 were there. He was the only one, because he was the only one that had the revelation that Jesus loved him. Let's take Peter into account. After Jesus had died and resurrected, we see Jesus and Peter having a little conversation. This is in John chapter 21, verse 15 to 17. "So when they had eaten breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me more than these? He said to him, Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. He said to him, Feed my lambs. He said to him again a second time, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me? He said to him, Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Jesus said to him, Tend my sheep. He said to him a third time, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me? Peter was grieved because he said to him the third time, Do you love me? And he said to him, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. Jesus said, Feed my sheep. So why was Jesus asking Peter, Do you love me? Well, if you go back to chapter 13 in the Gospel of John, you'll see there's a passage there that tells us a little bit. Verse 34 to 38, Jesus says, "A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this all will know that you are my disciples, if you have love one for the other." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, where are you going?" Jesus answered him, "Where I am going, you cannot follow me, but you shall follow me after." And Peter said to him, "Lord, why can't I follow you now? I will lay down my life for your sake." You know, in other words, he's saying, "I'll follow you to the end." Jesus answered him, "Will you lay down your life for my sake? Most assuredly, I say to you, the rooster shall not crow till you have denied me three times." We all know that Peter, when Jesus was taken to the cross, three times Peter denied to even knowing him. And the point is that Peter is focused on his love for Christ. Our love is conditional, and it can fail us. But Jesus' love is unconditional, and it's perfect. Whereas John had the revelation that Jesus loved him, it took him all the way to the cross. But the disciple who was focused on his love for Jesus, it let him down. And so if you go to that cross with the realization that he loves you, you'll see the greatest act of love the world has ever known. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." Now we've heard this preached many times. We tend to think that this is the gospel. Whoever believes in Jesus will have everlasting life. And we tend to take that, especially the church, and preach that if you call on the name of Jesus, you'll be saved from hell. But that's not entirely true. We need to really be careful with our words when we preach the gospel. So what does the Bible say we are saved from? In Matthew 1, verse 21, "She shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins." You see, we're not saved from hell. We're saved from sins. So why is it that Jesus came to save us from our sins and not just from hell? It's because sin separates man from God. Romans 6:23 says that the wages of sin is death. God detests sin. He can't even look upon it. And whenever you're in sin, you're separated from God. He is holy and he is just and he cannot come near it. So what gives sin its power? What makes sin so powerful that it would separate us from God? And this is the part the church tends to leave out. 1 Corinthians 15:56. "The strength of death is sin." The sting of death is sin. And the strength of sin is the law. Wow. It's the law that gives sin its power. We can see this in the garden. Genesis chapter 2, 16 and 17 says, "The Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat, but of the tree of knowledge and good and evil you shall not eat of it, for in the day that you eat thereof thou shalt surely die." You see, in the garden there was only one law. If the devil wanted to ruin mankind, why didn't he tempt Eve to kill Adam? If he wanted to just wipe mankind off the face of the earth, why didn't he just tempt Eve to kill Adam? It's because there was no law saying thou shalt not kill. In the garden, this was the only law. Thou shalt not eat from that tree. So what gave Satan his power? What's the very thing he used to tempt Adam and Eve with? Genesis 3, 1 through 4. "The serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, hath God said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden?" Now see there, he's perverting it. But look what he's doing. He's using the one law that exists in this garden. He's perverting that law and tempting the woman with the law. "The woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. And the serpent said unto the woman, ye shall not surely die." See, there's the temptation. The one thing that gave the Satan power to tempt Eve was that one law. He's called the accuser of the brethren. Think about that a minute. If there's no law to break, what's to be accused of? Well, if that's the case, then why was the law even given? Why did God put this law in here if it's going to condemn us to death? If it's going to give Satan power to tempt us, and if we can't keep the law because the law is perfect, we're imperfect. Even the Jews couldn't keep the law. That's why they had to offer sacrifices. So why was it given? Galatians chapter 3, 23-25 says, "But before faith came, we were kept under the law, shut up unto the faith which should afterwards be revealed. Wherefore the law was our schoolmaster to bring us unto Christ, that we might be justified by faith," not by the law, but by faith. "After that faith has come, we are no longer under a schoolmaster." You see, this is saying that the law was to teach us. In other words, the law showed us how wretched we are. And it showed us that we cannot be perfect. We cannot be holy on our own ability. It was to show us how much we need a Savior. Right there it says, to bring us unto Christ. The law reveals our sins. That's what it does. It reveals to us how wretched we are. Romans 5:12-13 tells you this. "Therefore, just as through one man sin entered the world, and death through sin, thus death spread to all men because of sin. For until the law, sin was in the world, but sin is not imputed," which means taken into account, "where there is no law." In other words, before the Ten Commandments came, people were sinning. Sin was in the world, but their sins were not taken into account because there was no law to condemn them with. You know, there's a verse in the New Testament that says, "Blessed is the man whose sins are not imputed to them." The law was not given to save you. Romans 8, verse 3. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God, sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh. That's an important phrase to remember. You see, people wonder why Christians, especially Christians, tend to fall back into sin when they're supposed to be living a holy life and they're supposed to believe in Jesus and do the right thing. Why do they continue to sin? Jesus didn't wipe away sin. He didn't abolish it. It's not completely destroyed and taken out of the earth. You were condemned because of your sins. But when Jesus hung on that cross and took your place, he condemned sin in the flesh, in the flesh of Jesus. Jesus took our punishment in his flesh. Therefore, God condemned sin itself in the flesh instead of condemning us. And whatever is condemned is separated from God. But notice, the sin is just condemned. It's not abolished. It's not gone. That means it is still in the flesh. So your sinful nature, when a law is presented, can cause that sinful nature to rise up and to be stirred up, causing us to be tempted to make mistakes. But blessed is the man whose sins are not imputed to them, because he remembers our sins no more. But today, people try to earn their righteousness. They try to uphold that law. Even Christians, instead of receiving the free gift of God, the salvation on the cross, they want to come to Jesus and then say, now I've got to try to live by the law. But the more you try to obey that law, the more you try to do it, the easier it is to fall. But if you look, it's called self-effort. You're trying to earn your righteousness. Most people try to please God. You know, I need to read my Bible more. I need to go to church more. I need to fast more. I'm not witnessing enough. I'm not tithing enough. Because they feel like they're not pleasing God. The more I do, the more God will bless me. If I do this or don't do that, then maybe I can get the favor of God and he will answer my prayers. It's called self-effort. And all it is legalism. It's trying to earn your righteousness instead of accepting the free gift of righteousness. You see, Jesus was the end of the law.